Greetings. My name's Dave Rankin. I'm an elder here at Central Presbyterian Church in Tarentum. Pastor Bob Dayton is currently away on vacation. We've been blessed with an offering from Rebecca Reeder this past week in our devotionals. Rebecca is the associate pastor of the Presbyterian Church of Sewickley, and I'm going to present the devotional for this week. On Sunday mornings, we've been blessed with guest speakers. Mr. Ed Saxon was here last Sunday. He is a representative of the Gideon Society. Today in the pulpit, our friend Sandra McKee was here to preach. Sandra is a lay minister in the United Methodist Church system. And this coming Sunday, Reverend Carolyn Jones will be our guest minister. Carolyn was the pastor for several years at the First United Presbyterian Church here in Tarentum, is currently retired and doing pulpit supply work in Pittsburgh Presbytery. We're pleased to have these friends with us and are grateful for their offerings in our ministry. You may remember that some months ago I presented some devotional material about the liturgical calendar and the seasons of the church year. We're currently in the season often called Ordinary Time. It's the series of Sundays between Pentecost and Christ the King Sunday. Pentecost is the Christian holiday celebrated 50 days after Easter, and Christ the King Sunday is the last Sunday of the liturgical year. It's the Sunday right before the first Sunday of Advent and the Christmas season. So it's a long span of time, a long series of Sundays, and some people call it ordinary time. Some people just call it the Sundays after Pentecost. I'll read again from the Book of Common Worship. The Sundays after Pentecost, like the Sundays after Epiphany, are sometimes called ordinary time, not because they are routine or mundane, but because their primary rhythm has to do with following the Sundays in order. Indeed, each Sunday is a celebration of Christ's resurrection from the dead on the first day of the week, and it is this holy mystery that animates, renews, and transforms our life of faith. Our times of worship are primarily times of prayer, from the beginning to the end of the service. The litanies at the beginning of the service, the times of private and corporate confession, and the hymns and other music are really all forms of prayer. Of course, our services include instruction through reading scripture and listening to a sermon, a meditation on a scripture passage, or some other form of lesson. But even these are sprinkled with prayer. Most of the following material is from the Book of Common Worship, the daily prayer edition that's been prepared by the Office of Theology and Worship for the Presbyterian Church USA and published by the Westminster John Knox Press. The practice of daily prayer is a way of living out our baptism, dying and rising with Christ. Each night we rest in Christ's peace. Each morning we rise to walk in newness of life. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18 tell us, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." We respond to God's grace through the gift of prayer. The Christian life is one of constant prayer, as the challenge of everyday discipleship requires daily disciplines of faith. Prayer is a way of opening ourselves to God, who desires communication and communion with us. Prayer may take a variety of forms, such as conscious conversation with God, attentive and expectant silence, meditation on Scripture, the use of service books, devotional aids, and visual arts, and singing, dancing, labor, or physical exercise. The church's pattern of daily prayer may be adopted as an individual practice of faith. Prayer may be also expressed in action through public witness and protest, deeds of compassion, and other forms of disciplined service. Prayer is meant to be a gracious gift from God, not a task or an obligation. It's an opportunity to draw inspiration and strength from one's relationship with God in Jesus Christ. It is a way of continually seeking the gifts and guidance of the Holy Spirit for daily living. Prayer is a practice to cultivate throughout one's life, and one that will bear much fruit. Let us pray. Almighty God, you call your church to witness that in Christ we are reconciled to you. Help us so to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may turn to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A Reflection on Heaven by Harold Myra. Some selections from 1 Peter about new life forever. Now we live with great expectation, and we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. So be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. These trials will show that your faith is genuine, for you have been born again, but not to a life that will quickly end. Your new life will last forever. Jesus made it clear that heaven is a real place when he told his followers that he would prepare a place for them. Having come from heaven, he had a vivid sense of what it was like. Yet we don't see in the Gospels what he meant and how he described it. Jesus emphasized that the most important thing about heaven was the fact that his Father was there. Images of golden streets and trumpeting angels fade beside Jesus's emphasis that in heaven we will be welcomed home by our Father. And that starts right now. He advised we store our treasures in heaven, warned that we must forgive others so our Father in heaven will forgive us, and said that those who do the will of his Father are the ones who will enter heaven. Jesus lived with a two-world perspective, and he calls us to share his worldview. Yet the glories and welcome of heaven can seem distant in competition with our wired, colorful, demanding world. We may hear wonderful things about heaven, yet our dread of death may make us shove its realities to the backs of our minds. Some have likened our brief stay on earth to schooling for heaven, and to death as our graduation. We see graduating students exuberantly throw their caps into the air in celebration. The hard part is over, and they're ready to reap the promised benefits. Do we view our entrance into heaven that way? Jesus knew earth was in stark contrast to his native country with his Father. What are our expectations of what's ahead after our brief sojourn here? And how does that affect our thoughts and actions for us now? It's hard for us to imagine living forever, dear Lord. What will our life actually be like? How different will our bodies be? How many of those descriptions of heaven in books and movies will match up to what we will experience? We love the images of coming to this warm home of our Heavenly Father. So help us, Lord, to focus on the essentials about heaven, about your grace, your righteousness, and redemption. Let us pray. Father in heaven, keep us in step with your Spirit today and every day, with that inner sense that there is wonderful joy ahead in heaven.
We invite you to visit our church website at cpcturanum.org to learn more about our ministries. You can also visit us on Facebook at Central Presbyterian Church Turanum. Please join us as we renew lives, inspire hope, and serve others. God bless you.